I believe with all of my heart that God has purposed to bring all the Hindus and all the Muslims and all the Buddhists and all the atheists right here to America so there could be a great outpouring of His Spirit and all the nations of the earth be set on fire with the glory of heaven right here on these shores. I can't even imagine a church that is so running in fear and so without the glory and the power of God that they would be afraid of the devil. That they would be afraid of some little spook behind a corner and under a bed. Just give me 5 minutes with somebody from ISIS. Just give me 5 minutes with them. Sopakara sapaya. The one who's on the inside of me is greater than anyone who's on the inside of those who do not know God in Christ Jesus. I told Ann today, I said, I'm going to write him a letter. I'm going to write Obama a letter. I'm going to write the governor a letter. I said, bring him to me. I'll take care of them, as many as I possibly can stuff in the closets. I'll be the answer to every Syrian Christian's prayer. I mean, I'm willing to go and give my life in Syria for the gospel. How much more would I be willing to bring them here and give my life? What's wrong with the people around here? I pray in the name of Jesus, you quit thinking like the world, start thinking like the Father. I pray in the name of Jesus, you start taking your advice from the Holy Ghost instead of some demon ghost, some unholy ghost. I pray you stop listening to men, start listening to the Father. Hallelujah. I'm not kidding you, I'm right, President. I'm going to say, dear President Obama, I have a very large ranch in Oregon and I'm certain I could take care of as many as you can send me. Dear Governor of Oregon, I'm so blessed that you, when everybody else is turning tail and running, are still willing to keep the doors of sanctuary open to a people who are being persecuted. I just like to see some of these folks that don't want to help anybody. I'd like to see them in that condition, see what they're going to be doing. Oh, God. Listen, I can't help it that things haven't been going right for you. If you had listened to God and walked in the Spirit, you'd have the best life you could possibly imagine. You would not have one day of hell. You'd have days of heaven upon earth. You would not have another day of hell and torment. You'd have not another day of complaint and sorrow. You'd have not another day of discouragement and disappointment. There'd be days of heaven. And not living days of heaven upon the earth. And it commanded the same for our house. And so I'm so blessed to have Daniel and Summer Spitzberg in here tonight. They're getting ready to start a youth outreach, youth ministry in Bonanza. And hallelujah. You know, Bonanza. And a fire of God's going to begin to burn in Bonanza. And you see how it burn up the whole map. Oh, I can just take that as just a prophetic word from heaven. Hallelujah. I mean, I'm just in expectation of great things. I mean, I think one of the most, I get excited over everybody running for cover. I mean, that just like, I mean, it's, you know, I'm into the battle. I'm into the fight. That's just the way it works for me anyways, as we live, the way we live. I like the idea of nobody having any food so that we can take a few loaves and fishes and multiply and feed the multitude. I like the idea of nobody having a job and there being total 100% unemployment. We'll just have a great, grandiose Holy Ghost meeting, man, last day in, day out. Woo! Somebody said, well, what are we going to eat? Well, that's what they were saying, Jesus. What are we going to eat? Wherewith shall we be clothed? then Jesus looks at him like, what on earth? Have you no idea what's going on in heaven? Don't you know what you're supposed to be and what you're supposed, how you're supposed to live and the miracle provision of heaven that has been a supply to you? What, you just haven't even begun to think right yet. You're still stuck in an earthly realm thinking after the manner of men. Father wants to bring you over into a glorious realm. People, parents teaching their kids to go and give their life working to make the devil some money so they barely have any time to serve God. Can you imagine that? Did I teach you that? Did I show anybody in my house they're supposed to go get a job and have some kind of vocation and slave away to make some demon power some money? To assimilate to a demonic strategy designed by the prince and the power of the air, the god of this world. God's going to have a people. Papa's going to raise up people. He's going to raise up people. You watch what happens. Father was willing to wait 420 years for Abraham to have a family. He'll find somebody who's willing to take a hold of the things of the kingdom of God and begin to minister the culture of the kingdom of God. That will break free of the culture of this world, the culture of the Amorites and the Hittites, the Satanicites. I'm not going to stand by and watch Satan try to take over things. He's going to have to get somebody else's generation. I'm going to lift up my voice and come on, man, I'll tell you right now. You walk with God, you let the Spirit of the living God take over you, and I don't care where you're at. You may be in some isolated place in the backwoods of nowhere, and your prayers will change the atmosphere of the whole world. Your prayers will change. Ask Job. Your prayers will change the atmosphere of whole nations. Ask Daniel. Your prayers will bring redemption to a lost and dying world. Ask Jesus. The little postage size stamp of a nation, Israel. Huh? Barely bigger than our backyard. Hallelujah. Kasta pokoranaya. Listen to me. Amaze karaboli stiperinia. Hangalea pokanasha piatusta. I pray tonight you'll begin to dream big in God. You'll begin to see what Jesus did for you and you get out of the world. And get out of your own system and out of the culture that Satan designed and come over here and begin to live by the word and step into God's heavenly realms of divine power and glory. He's given to a new race of people. A people who've been washed in the blood and born of the Spirit. A people who are heirs of God and co-inheritors of Christ Jesus. That's a new race of people. Abraham began a new race of people that did not exist upon the face of the earth until he entered into covenant with God. A new race came into existence. They called Ivrites, Hebrews, which means those who stand on the other side of the flood with God. Hallelujah. They became Israel, those who wrestle with the Almighty. Whoa, Makashe Paradaya. Come on, man. Come on, man. The only reason people don't get this is because they so conform to the world. They so integrated into a demonic system. Somebody said, well, you just espouse and then we should go quit our jobs. No, I'm talking, you should be allied unto Christ Jesus at your job, and it should not be the source of your provision. It should just be a stop in a long place, a training ground for another mission field that's bigger than the one you got right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Moramanjaya Pakai. I like to come and see your office and see signs up everywhere. Jesus saves, the blood of Jesus washes whiter than snow. I mean, come on. What's the profit of man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? They can't get in your office and out of your office without getting the whole counsel of God. Hallelujah. And then your break time, if you've got an office, you're down on your knees praying for Holy Ghost conviction to fall upon the place. Somebody comes in your office, it's barely hard for them to stand. Hallelujah. Mande risato kuri masebelia. I just praise God that there's not going to be a people in the abiding place that's going to leave all the work to a few. Amen. I praise God that there's not a bunch of people going to leave all the work to a few. And I'm day right now. You listen to me. God's not interested in the work of our hands. He's interested in us coming under His authority and moving by His Spirit and doing it His way. Because His way is the only way that works. It's got to be done by the Holy Ghost. And what you're doing, if what you're doing can't be put under the floodlight of heaven and evaluated as to whether or not it's by the Holy Ghost, huh? Then you got yourself a problem. You want your whole life to be examined by Him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
My goodness, I'm so desperate for the things of heaven, and I'm so desperate for increase in the anointing, increase in the power and the presence of God, being able to have free course through our lives. Come on, people. This is who we are. We're hungry and we're thirsty for the things of heaven. We're hungry and thirsty to be used by God in another way. You have to quit. Then, if we're gonna do that in a greater way, we're gonna have to quit thinking our own thoughts. Next time you think your own thoughts, rebuke them in the name of Jesus. Cast it down.
Amen.
You know, Josiah was a great example of revival. There was no one like Josiah. He's one of the greatest examples of revival in the Old Testament. You ought to make a study of Josiah's life. How radical he was for God. He didn't let anything that didn't look like God and His purposes to exist in the kingdom. He tore it down. He broke it in pieces. There's people in this place tonight. You've erected things in your life. You need to tear them down, bust them into pieces. You've allowed the gods of this world to influence you. You've allowed the atmosphere of this world to influence you. You've allowed that which men have exalted as important and necessary to become that which is important to you and necessary to you. And God's not sharing anything important, and He's not sharing anything necessary. Just understand it. He'll stand waiting patiently with His goodness, waiting till all that is important to you is Him, and that all that is necessary to you is Him. And He'll work with you, and He'll deal with you. But until that's the way it is, you're going to be who you are. And you pray all you want, and you can fast all you want, but if it doesn't work, a surrender and consecration in your life to where that He is all that you desire, He is all that is important to you, and He's all that's necessary, it won't profit you anything. You hear me?
Yes.
This is true. Tonight, of course, once again, we're going to minister, hallelujah, on the blood and the body of Jesus. You know, I just set in my heart that God's people in this place are going to begin to understand what Jesus Christ has done for them. You're going to be able to see. Your eyes are going to be open to understand. I mean, I guess it was probably about 3 weeks ago, and I looked over and the Lord began to deal with me, and I didn't see any of the elements of communion on the table, and it was a bad sign. Uh-oh. I pray we never look into your life and don't see the elements of communion on the table. Hallelujah. Partaken. Hallelujah. Of this wonderful grace that God has given to us. Tonight we're going to show forth the death of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Yeah, we are.
Yeah.
And if by His death we were changed, how much more shall we be saved by His life?
Whoa.
whoever liveth to make intercession for the saints. I'm telling you right now, we're not only going to show forth His death, we're going to show forth His coming. Hallelujah. Because the scripture says we show forth His death until He comes. So we're sitting here waiting on Him to come. I guarantee you Paul didn't leave out the resurrection in that verse. Because we raised up together. Well, I'm living with Him. I'm living in Him. For me to live is Christ. Hallelujah. How about you? It's for you to live you, and you hope one day for you to be live as Christ. Then you're living in doubt and unbelief. That's like you saying, someday I hope that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's like you, someday I hope I'm going to be born from above and my heart will be changed. No, the Lord gave us this unspeakable gift of His life. Hallelujah. Yes, He did. I like that. One person got a strong response. You start doing that, you're going to get yourself a strong response to the Holy Ghost. See, it's not man talking. People just want to make it man. They want to make it a religious man-made thing. It's not a man-made thing. It's God talking. And see, what you're going to learn how to do is you're going to learn how to respond, a strong response to the Holy Ghost. No matter how He begins to move, whether it's at night and he begins to stir you in the night and wakes you up and you know you're supposed to get in prayer. You know, many times we don't know what we're supposed to pray for. We just know we're supposed to pray. We keep a sensitive, tender heart towards the Lord as we ministered about this morning. Hallelujah. God has given us a heart just like him so we can be sensitive to those things that please him and to those things that grieve him. Hallelujah. So we can move with him. Praise God. He's baptized us in the Holy Ghost so that we can learn how to speak after the manner of heaven. Hallelujah. So we can learn how to talk like God. We learn how to talk like the devil most of our life. Doubt and unbelief and shame and murmuring and complaining and bickering and fussing and fighting all about our own self-interest because somewhere we didn't get our way. I pray today that you'll just say, Lord, I want you to change me to where I never want my way ever again. I want you to help me and strengthen me. See, you know, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And we come to renew our strength because the world around us is in need of seeing Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 There's so many dimensions of God's covenant that he wants to establish with us. There's so much room for growth and maturity in all of our lives. But we have to change. We have to cooperate with God. The reason that you don't have more in your life that God has for you is because the way you're living and the way you're acting. You want more? Then you're going to get desperate enough to say, I'm going to change. I'm going to be different. I'm not going to act like this anymore. Somebody said, how different should I be? Just read the Bible. How should I act? Just read the Word of God and do it. Oh, yeah. Praise God. And you know, the beautiful thing, people, is you start giving yourself to the weapons of your warfare, which are not carnal but mighty, the weapons of the Word of God, letting the Word of God be the means by which you process the way you think, the way you behave. It rules your attitudes, your appetites, your emotions, and your desires. Oh, dear people, things begin to radically change in our lives. The inheritance of God and the riches of God begin to overwhelm us to where that by giving ourselves to the Word, we just have much more desirous of the Word. And now our tongue is like the pen of a ready writer. And when we speak, we're speaking His Word out of His counsel. Hallelujah. His instruction. And then we give ourselves to the weapon of our warfare, which are not carnal but mighty through God's power of praying. Praying in the Holy Ghost with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. You know, last night I was just sitting around and the Holy Ghost grabbed me. I was sitting around trying to do my own thing. Sleep. Rest. I get up. Translated for a while. God, the Holy Ghost, he grabbed me. He grabbed me because he wanted to take me to a place of prayer. I could feel it. I'm sitting there trying to translate. And the Holy Ghost says, come here. I'm trying to translate. I feel the bubble up. And that's him saying, come here. Batorin. Now I'm starting to get so distracted I can't translate. Spakadan. So then finally, it was just overwhelming. That overwhelming going. Now there's nothing to do but just go apart into a quiet and silent place. Where God begins to have the permission to take rule over you. See, Father is not going to transgress our will, but there comes a place where our will has been proven to be His. And now He takes over. Where it's no longer Him transgressing our will. He just steps in and tells us, okay, this is what you're going to do now. Come here. But there's going to be a trying on that. There's going to be an evaluation on that. There's going to be time and time again where Father's going to find out whether or not I'm going to do it my way or His way. Because tonight I want you to say again, because it's been a part of my life, Lord, not my will, but your will. Father, I don't want to do my own will. I don't want to have my own will. Lord, you said that you would cause me, make me to walk in your statutes. That you would cause me to make me to walk in your ways. I want to be made. Some people just want to be caused. I want to be made. Hallelujah. Just give yourself to the things of the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. Miracle, power of God in the house.
Amen.
Mick. The Ancient of Days is here. I can feel him. I felt the Ancient of Days when I walked in, and I felt the Ancient of Days. I started feeling the Ancient of Days in a way that I felt him when I was a real little guy in some of the great revival meetings that I was privileged to be in when I was 4, 5, 6 years old. He's here, believe me. Does it matter how you are able to perceive? I'm not making this up. He's here. I'm not just saying that based upon the word. I could say that based upon the word of good authority, but I'm telling you right now, based upon the word and the reality of his presence being made manifest right now. You know, we're just praying about seeing Mike get released to all those Native American around us out there in Oregon. Seeing the Holy Ghost fire get stirred up there. If the Lord does that in his life. One of the last things I'd want to do is lose the helps that's here that might, I'm going to tell you right now, a lot of people are going to have to work, keep up with, to make up for the slack. I love it when people give themselves to the work of the ministry. Don't leave all the work to just a few in every dimension. Oh, well, Pastor, he's going to be on his knees praying. We don't need to. We'll sit over here and complain. They're going to be crying out to God. We're just going to be over here doing our own thing. They'll take care of it. Oh, dear people. I pray you begin to be stirred by the fires of the Holy Ghost in a deeper way than you've ever been stirred. Because that's what God's doing. I'm being stirred. Listen, I'm telling you, I'm being stirred by the fires of the Holy Ghost in a deeper way than I've ever had in my life. It's happening right now. God is calling me into a greater consecration to living for him than I've ever had in my life. One of the things, Richard Moore came and he said, "Listen, let me just tell you what God's been doing." He starts talking to me and I start talking to him. He starts talking to me, I start talking to him. And it's just like the whole subject is about God calling us, beckoning us to come over into the realms of being so isolated and separated under the realms of his holiness, the realms of his moving. We were in some place, what was it called, Fish House or something like that. Holy Ghost just came, just set Bataranaya, right down at the Patolamashi, Hastapri, the Parotea, right down in the midst of the fellowship. Did you know that's what he does? Did you know when you begin to have fellowship, when you begin to interact with each other around the Word of God, around the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost begins to move in a greater way like that? Did you know that? I don't care who you with. Did you know that when you begin to speak out the Word of God over your life, rather than all the other stuff over your life, that the Holy Ghost begins to work and develop within your life, the reality of that, the agreement with God of that which he's already done, not the doubt and the unbelief of asking God to do something in the future, which he said he already did in the past. That's just a doubt and unbelief prayer. And there are many people who pray it, but listen to me. Don't feel too bad. I used to pray doubt and unbelief prayers too. And God, the Holy Spirit, came into my prayer room and said, "Listen, I'm tired of this. This is not the way it works." Hallelujah. And I learned how to pray the Word of God. Hallelujah. Pray by the Spirit. Hallelujah. Call it done. Bereshengaya. Halamangeta. Hallelujah. We all might look cute laying around like this, but we're not going to get much work done in the kingdom. We might be adorable by the Lord. He loves us, I tell you right now. But not a lot's going to happen. Not a lot's going to happen. When I was a child, I spake as a child. But I put away childish things. I've recognized that I'm an heir of God. Will you listen, man, I tell you right now. When you recognize that you're an heir of God, you got no more issues. You got no more worries. You got no more problems. You don't need to do it by the arm of flesh anymore. You know, God's people kind of got it upside down. They've already had their Isaac, and now they want to get a Hagar and have an Ishmael too. I mean, I can understand Sarah and Abraham basically on the program of needing, you know, a Hagar before they had an Isaac. But come on, why we got it all upside down? Having been born of the Spirit by a miracle. Whew. Having begun in the Holy Ghost, now be made perfect by the Holy Ghost. Learn how to walk on the water. Stop whatever it is you're doing and start learning how to walk on the water. And you don't need to go out there on the ocean to practice. You can start right there at the very principles of the things that is causing you fear and concern and distracting you and preoccupying you and taxing you to where you got nothing left for God or very little. Hallelujah. 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 God wants to show us how to do it right. To do it in the Holy Ghost. To do it by His power and by His Spirit and by His might. To do it just like He described in His Word. Hallelujah. And if we're willing to be taught of God, see, the Spirit of the Lord has anointed us. We have received an anointing from Him. And we don't need to be taught of men. This one and most important thing, this anointing that we've received of Him that teaches us all things, is taught us to dwell, to abide, to have our whole existence in the identity of Jesus, to dwell and exist in the person of Jesus Christ. And a lot of what we're talking about when we're talking about communion is really just about that. It's about what He's done by the offering up of His blood at Calvary's cross to cause us to be able now to come near unto the Father, to be born into the family, to be a part of this new race that began with Jesus. A new race began with Abraham. Everybody can say amen to that. Amen. I can't help it that a lot of folks haven't been willing to embrace the family that we've been born of. Hallelujah. It was a race that went extinct shortly after the creation. It's true. Shortly after the creation, the race went extinct. How? Because Satan was able to enter in and deceive men. And Adam walked out of the family of God and became a child of the devil. And all of his descendants were children of the devil. So that Jesus, standing there, even looking at the best of the best, says, "Your father," He says, "I'm from above, you from beneath. I'm not of this world, you're of this world. Your father is the devil." That's some spiritually messed up situation. You talk about dysfunctional. You see what hear what I'm saying to you? We've been born of the Spirit. We've been made alive by the Word of God and by the resurrection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, that's got to become something that's so exciting. It'll create a response in you any time of the day, especially in church when God, the Holy Ghost, is surrounding it with His glory. I mean, those kinds of things get me excited even when I'm up against disaster and persecution. Hallelujah. All the opposition, I just start declaring the word. God works a miracle through the declaration of the word. When the word of God is something that is more than just ideas and concepts, but it's living. The Word of God will take you and bring you right over into the faith of it. Hallelujah. It's true that your faith will never go beyond your confession. And I'm talking about the confession of God's Word. Amen. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For the abundance of all things. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For the abundance of all things. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I pray that you'll let the Holy Spirit do that which He wants to do in you so that you can find the excitement of communing with Him, just talking to Him. Sometimes it's the conversation is just so deep, you're just whispering back and forth to each other. Just the way it is sometimes. God, He's amazing. Sometimes it's thunderous because of that which God is doing in our life as it begins to cry out through us for a lost and dying world and a needy church. Oh, it's so much of a blessing to be able to walk with the Holy Ghost and let Him begin to show us the realms of the Spirit. Allow us to see the various different glorious realms of how the Holy Ghost moves. It's almost like going and visiting different rivers and seeing different bodies of water, and beholding different dimensions of His creation. We're just overwhelmed by it. Hallelujah. I pray tonight that you get out of your sorrow and your sadness because it's demonic. I pray tonight that you get out of your aggravation and the communion with your own mind because it isolates you from the presence of the Lord. I pray tonight that you surrender yourself over to the Word of God and to the Spirit of God. And that which He brings is all that you desire. And it becomes the conversation of your mouth and the thinking of your heart. And you'll hear what God said. It's not changed. It's the same today as it was in the day that He said it to Joshua. In Joshua 1:6 and 1:8, continually recite the words of this covenant. You may observe to do all that is written therein. Then shall you make your way prosperous and you shall have good success. Hallelujah. Can you just imagine what good life you're going to have if you just allow your thoughts to be saturated with the Word of God? And in that consecration and commitment to Him. See, you know, Jesus said to the disciples, said, your spirit's willing, but your flesh is weak. See, my spirit is willing, so the Holy Ghost hooks up with me and gives me divine ability to do it. I'm not even in that dynamic anymore. They weren't in that dynamic after that they got filled with the Holy Ghost. And because I want His Word. I want to retain His Word. See, there were many who they didn't like to retain the knowledge of God, so God said, I gave them over to a reprobate mind. They didn't want to retain the knowledge of God. I want to retain the knowledge of God. I want to retain it completely and totally. I don't want to, you know, not be willing to retain it, and then all of a sudden it continues to get worse in a worse state. It's a disease state. It's a spiritual disease state, not wanting to retain the knowledge of God, rather being willing to choose the knowledge of this world, the knowledge of men, the knowledge of thoughts that Satan would throw at us. You hear what I'm telling you? I love retaining the knowledge of God because it has the opposite effect. I love the mind of Christ. I love walking in the mind of Christ. When you walk in the mind of Christ, you're in the mind of Christ, you get excited about it. You don't get bummed out. When you walk in the mind of the Spirit, you love the mind of the Spirit. You get excited about it. You love the things that the Spirit of the Lord of God is saying. You love the adjustments that God makes in your life. Come on. Hallelujah. You know what? Papa gives everybody a will. You can choose by your actions and by your deeds and by your responses to God to walk in your own way and walk in your own will, or you can choose by your actions and your deeds and your responses to give your will over to the Father's will. To say as the preacher's daughter said in 1880 in the Holiness Revival, take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Hallelujah. Take my heart, it is your throne. Hallelujah. Take my heart, it is your own, and it shall be your royal throne. Hallelujah. A new heart that has got His Word written in it. My mind has His Word inscribed in it. My life existing by the very life imparted to me by the blood of Jesus Christ. Satan having no claim. Living as a son of God with the Spirit of the Son inside of my heart, crying out, Abba, Father. Having purified my heart and obeying the truth through unfeigned love of the brethren. Hallelujah. See that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Hallelujah. Because a pure at heart, they see God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Pure heart is defined by those who are going to meditate on His Word day and night, and those who cry out and say, Holy Spirit, I want only You and all of You. I don't want to live out any other kind of life except for the one that You describe and that You empower me to have. Hey, listen, who shall ascend into the mountain of the Lord? Who shall dwell in the holy place? Those who have clean hands and a pure heart, who's not lifted up their soul to a vanity, to the things that have no lasting value, a bank account, your reputation, all the other stuff that the God of this world imposes upon you right now. I'm not lifting my soul up to vanity. See, none of it means anything to me. My truck doesn't mean anything to me. My car doesn't mean anything to me. My clothes don't mean anything to me. The house don't mean anything to me. The furniture don't mean anything to me. The stuff that we have doesn't mean anything to me. I just want to preach the gospel. I just want to move in Him. I want to flow in the Holy Ghost. I want to have more effect on the lost and dying world. I want to stand for Him. I'm ready to go. I have no baggage. I have no bags to pack. Oh, Lord, wait just a minute. I got my bags. I got to pack them. I have no bags to pack. Hallelujah. I got nothing I want to take with me from here to there. Hallelujah. I'm ready to go right now. Where are we going, Father? Hallelujah. I believe that it should be the cry of every one of our hearts. When we allow the Spirit of the Son to dwell in our hearts, our cry is going to be the cry that Jesus had, to do Thy will, O Lord. It is written of me. Yeah, in the midst of all the agony that he was going through, he said, Lord, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, Lord, Your will. I mean, he saw all that he was getting ready to have to go through. He was being pressed sorely by the powers of darkness there in such great agony and such intensity of prayer, and the enemy trying to kill him before he ever could get to the cross. Did he sweat, as it were, great drops of blood? Praise God, he went to the cross with us with joy, despising the shame, and now sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, expecting till his enemies be made his footstool, and looked at you and me and said, you seated together with me, come on in here. And I said, what? He said, you seated together with me. Oh, I'm coming right now. And thank you, Father. I'm just going to live here. Ain't nobody going to take that from me. You can be whatever you want to be. It's your choice. God's given you opportunity to be Him. Amen. Hallelujah. He's given an opportunity for you to have a change, an exchange of life. And tonight when we begin, I was just praying, about whether to minister to you on the message of the marriage supper of the Lamb that the communion table speaks of, and what Jesus, some of the things that Jesus meant and described when He said, I will not drink of this cup until I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, my. I don't have any. I'm telling you right now, I'm not going to stand before the Lord and Him say, you spent your whole life on yourself. You spent your whole life on a job. You spent your whole life on what's being burned up right now down there. Where's your car at now? Where's your truck at now? Where's your little pretty shiny little things at right now? You spent your whole life on that. You spent your whole life on your own security, consumed to your own will. I mean, that's going to happen. That's going to happen with me. Amen. He's going to look at me and He's going to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You spent your whole life. It was all about how you could take those things which I had given and trusted you and make profit out of them. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. That's what Father's going to say about you, Brittany. Hallelujah. Huh? And that's what the Father's going to say about you, sad face. Just get that sad face happy. Your face is sad because you're entangled with the world. You don't entangle with the world, you don't get no strings attached to you no more. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. You're happy all day long. You're burden free. Amen. We found how to live. We found how to live a glorious heavenly life. Burden free life. Forgive everybody. Love everybody. Bless everybody. Ooh. Hey, you don't go to bed with nothing on you. Carry anything from yesterday into the day. Hallelujah. Every day His mercies is new. Every day I walk into a deeper. I don't hold nothing on the back. I'm not looking back. Somebody said, I did something great in the past. Who cares? What are you doing right now? I want nothing. We'll talk about yesterday. If I ever start just talking about yesterday, I need to sit down. that somebody else is going to talk about today and what God's going to do in tomorrow. Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. You don't have to be beat up and beaten down. You don't have to be relegated to mediocrity or marginalized or worse than that. When God has prophesied such wonderful things over you, when He's engaged you into His life, into His abundance, into His miracle power, when you begin to lay a hold of the reality that you're an heir of God and a co-inheritor with Christ Jesus, that He's empowered you with all the riches of heaven to do all the things that He Himself does. My goodness gracious. The glory of this covenant is so far greater than the glory of the former covenant. And we've stepped into this covenant, and it's been ratified and established in our life by the blood of Jesus Christ. Yes. Even as the first covenant, even as the covenant that God entered into with Abraham was ratified and established by the blood, and it worked a miracle, even though it was a blood, a representative offering of the coming Redeemer, God's blood being poured out on an altar called Calvary for us. It still ratified the power and the authority of the covenant so that He was such a mighty prince with God. God, I mean, goodness gracious, you think about how God took care of him. I mean, you know, one day, I just love thinking about this, where he just told Sarah, just say you're my sister, you know, and he says to Abimelech, Abimelech looks at this woman as so beautiful, and, you know, and Abimelech takes her into his house, and Abraham doesn't say anything, and the Lord come to him that night and said, you are dead. See, that's just the way that God takes care of his people. Amen. Hallelujah. I mean, my. So call you a dead man. You done. That's my prophet. That's my friend. You better get up, make things right, and get him to pray for you quickly. I mean, that's just the overflow of the covenant made him an inheritor. He inherited the worlds to come as a result of the covenant. My, take Koshe. Look at all that they stepped into as a result of the covenant that was established there first and foremost in Egypt that night. When the blood was applied to the doorpost and to the lintel. When the blood of Christ Jesus, the Passover lamb, was being witnessed and testified to. When the reality of what God would do in spoiling, stripping Satan of his power, literally rearranging, reordering, changing it all back, removing all the hindrances out of the way through the blood of the cross. Reconciling, yea, both things in heaven and in earth. Changing it all back. Throwing Satan into outer darkness. Hallelujah. To hang out with the devil, you got to go into outer darkness to do it. To be occupied with the powers of doubt and unbelief, you got to go over into darkness. I thank God He's caused His light to shine into our hearts. Hallelujah. Right into my heart. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus came into my heart. Into my heart. Into my heart. Christ Jesus came into my heart. He's here today. Yes, He's here to stay. Christ Jesus came into my heart. He lives in me. He walks in me. He speaks through my lips, sees through my eyes, touches through my hand. It's the covenant. It's the new covenant. His word dominates my mind and my thinking, for it's written upon my mind supernaturally. Just like, and Paul uses the covenant language, just like God hewed out tablets of stone with his own fire and finger, and then with his own finger wrote upon them the law of life, that if they would walk in them, they should live. The written word of his will, so that he might dwell in their midst. So he's taken his finger and written upon the fleshly tables of my heart. Hallelujah. So that the word of Christ may dwell in me richly. Woo! Ha ha ha, they call you. Ha ha. Hallelujah. So that I can might be continually filled. Might be continually filled with the things of heaven. Yeah, but God's not going to transgress your will. These kind of things come as a result of you agreeing with God and proclaiming it. Maybe it just starts off, maybe your whole biblical vocabulary is thank you. That's all you know. In the spirit, all you know is thank you, Papa. That'll get you all the way to heaven. I'm going to tell you right now, that'll get you all the way in a miracle land. Start agreeing with God, but don't let anything else come out of your mouth. Don't let unthankfulness come out of your mouth. Don't let complaint come out of your mouth. It's a breach against the covenant. You think about all of the inheritance. That night, they spoiled the Egyptians. They spoiled the Egyptians. They said, I like that necklace. And then, I like that ring. Go give that to me. How much gold do you have over at your house? Go quickly get it. I need it. Hallelujah. Woo! Why? Because God put it in their heart to do it, and He put it in the heart of Israel to ask for it, to get it, to spoil it, because, you know, to the conquerors go the spoils. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. You know, I just love how it worked, you know, with Jesus. He spent 3 years training disciples. And at the moment of his greatest need, in the hour of his greatest conflict, they could not pray with him for 1 hour. Do you feel in good company? Their eyes were heavy with sleep. You know? He's like, comes the second time. He's like, they're still sleeping. Guys! Third time he came and said nothing. It's like. Then what he does is he goes and he champions our cause. And then gives to us the crown of victory as though we did it. Wow. Hallelujah. This is the covenant. Are you happy tonight?
Yes.
Are you excited about yourself? No. I think a lot of people, their whole salvation is based upon their self. They exalt themselves. If they feel good, then they're going to worship Jesus and be happy. You're going to see a little bit of heaven in their life. They're going to be a little bit of witness. Huh? You quit exalting yourself right now. Amen. You quit making it all about you. And start making Jesus bigger than you, and you're going to be happy all the time. You make Jesus bigger than you, and you're going to be happy all the time. Amen. You start exalting Him. You make it all about His goodness. I'm tell you right now, it'll get you past your faults and failings. It'll get you past your weakness and problems and issues. Because you just be captivated with Him, looking unto Christ Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. You know, we just like little children. You know, who can't keep up with the stride of a father. You know, it's just too much. But He causes us in His long-suffering, His patience, if you're willing. He calls you to grow. He calls you to mature. He's already given you His glory. He's already given you His likeness. But you're growing in the maturity of it. Listen, I'm today right now. You will, even in all the grace and all the gifting that God has given you, you will be prepared unto every good work. God's got a preparation process, and you better participate with it. You better quit fighting against the Holy Ghost. You better quit resisting the Holy Ghost. You want your heart to be circumcised. That's the new covenant. In the covenant that God gave to Abraham, there was an outward form of circumcision that was supposed to represent the mark of God. These are separated people. And God was always saying, I want your heart to be circumcised. I want your heart to be sensitive to me. I want your heart to be willing not to be calloused anymore and to be hard against my will and my purposes, but to be sensitive to me, to do what I've asked you to do. And so in the new covenant, the Lord brought to pass the circumcision of Christ, Colossians 2:11, where we're circumcised without the hands and the removal of the body of the sin of the flesh, so that the inward life and reality and beauty and splendor of all the Father has willed may be continually revealed in our lives. And yet we're going to go back and fashion ourselves after our former conversation and our lust. We're going to look back and say, oh my goodness, I want to go back to Egypt. We'll look back and say, I still want Sodom and Gomorrah. We'll turn aside and say, please, let me go over to Zoar. Let me go over. It's just a little city. Please, it's just a little one. That is the craziest conversation in the entire Bible. Lot trying to convince God that it's okay for him to go over to the other city of the plain because it's just a little one. Father's trying to give him a place to go. He wouldn't follow the hardness of his heart. God said he vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their conversation. People, watch out. Watch out. Watch out what you're allowing into your life. It'll rob you Satan's subtle in his tricks and his devices to steal from you. It'd take from you this joy. It'd take from you this holy communion. It'd take from you this boldness of faith. It will take from you your great confidence in God. Oh, prasedeki namundalase perishi. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesu Romoste. Thank you, Lord Jaroseveti. Thank you, living God. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you. Well, let me read a few verses of scripture to you because I love the Word of God. The Word of God will wash you. The washing of the water of the Word. Hallelujah. The Word of God causes you and I to think different. You can say renewed in the spirit of your mind if you want, but I'm going to tell you right now, get it done. You know what I'm saying? Quit playing around about it. You know what I'm saying? You can say that you're laying aside the weight and the sin that so easily besets you. Well, get it done. Let's start running the race. Because you got to lay aside before you can run the race. Let's get into the race. Huh? Let's just make a decision here tonight where we're... Listen, just go ahead and sell out to God. Why not? What else are you going to do with your life? Sell out to God.
Right.
Not halfway. Not in categories 1, 2, and 3. Not in categories as I looked over there at them and I'm doing as well as they are. Huh? But in the way in which Christ Jesus is described, that we no longer live. If you just start saying that to yourself, you say, I no longer live. Huh? We thus judge that if one died for all, then all are dead. Do you judge that? How many of you judge that? Paul judged that. What's the rest of you? What's the rest of the problem? Why can't the rest of you raise your hand? If I said, how many of you are saved? How many people would raise their hand? Just checking. Now, the Lord says, Paul said, we thus judge. If one died for all, then all are dead. I'm asking you now, how many of you judge that? Okay, good. Just checking. I'm sorry if I spoke too fast or a little slurry. I'm drunk in the Holy Ghost. I'm ready to get caught up. Amen. Hallelujah. And it's still a fool. The beautiful thing about it is you can live this way all the time. In fact, if it is, the more you live this way, the stronger it becomes. The more you give yourself to the manifest presence of God. I don't have time to have doubt and unbelief. It's too expensive. Huh? I miss out on the riches of God and the opportunities that would have come my way that I wasn't able to take hold of because I was off, you know, off the radar in God kind of thing. Come on, people. Let's get with the program. Let's walk in the Spirit. We thus judge if one died for all, then all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live to ourselves. You don't have the right to live for yourself. You and I have no right to do anything except for what the Master dictates. We have no right. We do no longer live unto ourselves, but unto Him who died for us and rose again. We have bought with the price. We're not our own. Our whole life is to be about doing the Father's will, glorifying Him in our body and our spirit, shining with the glory of heaven. If you're making your life about your job is going to consume you. There's going to be no light to see. It's going to be hid under a bushel. Huh? You're going to know to do good and not do it. You're going to know what your Father expected of you, but you didn't prepare. And the consequence and the outcome is not good for those folks. I pray you get a Holy Ghost fear in your life.
Amen.
I pray you get a fear of God. I got a fear of God, and I want even a greater fear of God in my life.
Amen.
And today, right now, the closer you get to Him, the more you allow Him to reveal Himself to you, because He's earnest to reveal Himself to you in all of His fullness. But you know, there's some conditions to be met if God's going to reveal the fullness of Himself to you. You have to be willing to be rooted and grounded and settled in love. You're going to have to be willing to be strengthened by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
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 You're going to have to be willing to be strengthened by the Holy Ghost in your inner being, and you being now rooted and grounded in love, now can be able to comprehend with all the saints this love of Christ which passes knowledge. And there, as a result of that, because you're willing to do that, what God is going to do then is He's going to call all His fullness to be revealed. He's going to fill you up with all of His fullness. Is that exciting? I'm like, let's do it now. Let's do it now. Let's do it now. Let's do it now. The Lord says, well, let's just take it one step at a time. We got a long time to get this thing done. Paul's not in a hurry. Oh, God, shouldn't you be in a hurry? I'm not in a hurry. Huh? There's a bush proverb. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. You know what I'm saying? Yes. Come on, listen to me. Listen to me. Father's not in a hurry. He's not in a hurry. He wants things to be established. Hallelujah. Serindo kashimoki ala batatana. Harastebrena sipoki lia fataya. Ejdurono. Erushaneme. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I guess my Bible's up here. Thank you, Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven and say, thank you, Jesus. You know, I discovered that if I'm not feeling that well, if I just start shouting and dancing around, everything changes. Okay, then I'll just ask you. I'll ask you, what have you discovered? Hey, what have you discovered? You don't like that one? Then tell me what you discovered. Changes everything. Amen. So if you haven't discovered anything, and I have discovered, if I discovered a gold mine, I mean, if I discovered, they call it the glory hole, if I discovered that place of great riches and said, I'll share it with you, and you turn up your nose, my goodness, what is wrong with you? I don't want it. Woo-hoo! Hallelujah. 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 Oh, thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Kosibandalipakashte. I believe that when Father deals with us sometimes and has to deal with us, and we're like a little child sitting at the table and will not eat our green beans. Everybody else has left the table. They're full. It was good. They had dessert. But Dad says, you got to eat your green beans, and you don't want to eat them. And it's just this big struggle. It's this standoff. Just do what Father says. Do it quickly. 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 Because if you wait 2 minutes, you can talk yourself out of it. You can grieve the Holy Ghost, you'll quench the Spirit. So Lord, just because it's quite a little suggestion, go in there and pray for that person. Go tell that person I love them. Just real subtle suggestion. Just subtle. Just a little inspiration. Just a little nudge. If you respond to that little inspiration, that little nudge, it'll get bigger. Amen. It'll become great, strong, compelling. It'll apprehend you. You won't even be able to resist. You'll just. Amen. It's like a tractor beam. You know what I'm saying? And when you get there, there's power and there's glory there. Amen. Come on, people. Yes. Let's just be about the Father's business. Be about the Master's business. Amen. 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 Open your Bibles to Romans chapter 5, verse 10. You know, I want you to be able to see what the blood has done for you and me. And I know I said opens Romans 5, 10, but Ephesians 2, 16 says we have been brought near to him by the blood. But the blood of Jesus Christ, according to what God said to us in Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, He's by the blood of the cross, he spoiled principalities. He stripped them of their authority. The means of the blood of Jesus Christ has brought us a complete deliverance from everything Satan would try to place upon us. He has no right by virtue of the power that is in the blood of Jesus Christ and the work of redemption that was brought to us, the remission of sin. The blood broke the chains of sin and death so that it could not have any hold on us. We can go back to it if we choose, but the blood broke its authority over all mankind's life. And when we start taking a hold of the elements of communion and we hold the cup in our hand, we're holding a symbolism of the means by which Satan lost all of his hold upon us, all of his sway over us, all of his power over us. We're holding in our hands the means by which God ratified the covenant that brings to us far more privileges and riches and inheritance than anything that he established with Abraham and anything that was revealed in Abraham or anything that was established or revealed in Israel. Because now the fullness of the covenant has come. It's something that they were waiting for. They themselves were waiting to happen. To where that now we've stepped into every dimension of what it means to rule and reign with Jesus Christ. People think it's going to happen just in the future. It's happening right now. Yeah. Romans chapter 5 will go on to say that we reign by one right now. We reign in him before sin reigned over us. Death reigned over us. The blood of Jesus is the means by which that was broken. It is the basis of all of our authority. As many as believed him, as received that which he gave us the authority to be sons of God. But the basis of that authority over Satan, over every claim that Satan would have upon our life, over everything he would try to impose upon us, is the blood that destroyed his power by which God changed everything, both in the earth and in the heavens. Amen. The blood holds a power and a decree in the heavenlies right now. That everything has completely been changed. That's what that word reconciled means. It's been changed. Somebody came along and tried to say, well, that means that God's going to reconcile all the fallen angels. That's not what that means. Because everything's been changed to a divine order where light is separated from darkness. It's not integrated anymore in any way. We've been delivered from the power of darkness and translated into this kingdom of the dear Son. The complete division of light and darkness, life and death. Righteousness and sin is defined by the blood. The blood that did it all for us. By his blood. By his blood. All by his blood. Not only by his blood. His blood has given me life. His blood it took my place. Redeeming sacrifice washes me whiter. Purified. All by the blood. Satan has no right. Just as the power of death and the claim of death that passed over Egypt that night had no power to touch those where the blood was applied. Upon my life right now, the blood of Jesus Christ is applied. Upon those who have been willing to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, he comes as the high priest and puts the blood upon you. He sprinkles the blood upon you like Moses sprinkled the blood upon the people and upon the covenant, ratifying it. He takes his blood and he sprinkles it upon us as it were. He entered into the blood. He entered in with his own blood into the holiest of holies before the throne of grace, before Father, and obtained for you and me eternal redemption. He didn't redeem us with riches such as silver and gold. He didn't come with the ransom of great wealth. He came, redeemed us with the precious, his own blood, like the blood of a precious and spotless lamb when there is no blemish. The means by which all satanic power lost its hold and right to touch us in any way. When we break the bread, it's a symbolism of literally walking through the veil. It's a means that we, as the high priest stood and couldn't go into the veil because on the other side of the veil was the altar of God and the throne of God. His flesh became to us as a veil. And the moment in time that his body died, the moment in time his body gushed out, his life blood, the veil of the temple was rent from the top to the bottom, and it's never been put back together. It's not been hanging since. There was a great earthquake. God came walking out of the holies of holies. And he's never gone back in. He stepped into the hearts and the life of everyone who took hold of the blood of the covenant. He became our God. We became his people.
Yes.
He said, this is the new covenant. I will be your God. Well, when will we just start letting God be our God? Instead of the arm of flesh be our God? When will we move out of the doubt and the unbelief and the fear and all the stuff that we try to produce? God don't need our help. He wants us to agree with him. Let him be God in the moment of great fear.
Yes.
Let him be God in the moment of great crisis. Amen. Let him be God in the moment of great pain.
Amen.
Let him God be God in the moment of great tribulation. Amen. Watch what happens to you. Watch what happens to you. The pain, the tribulation, the stuff becomes the things of the past. People that are in heaviness and through in many tribulations right now, it's because it's needed. Right. Praise God, I'm not, and I need to, it's on a need-to-need basis. I'd just rather go ahead and live over here in the joy unspeakable and full of glory, trust in God for everything. I'm not in the category of being needing to go through tribulation and trials so that the trying of my faith will get to a place where I'll let God be God and I'll be his people. I mean, we act like if we let God be God and that we're his people, I mean, begin to think about how good he is. Think about the benevolence. Think about the benefits. The beneficiaries. Halabokashiakaya. Halibura Nasaya. Hallelujah. Think about the benefits. I got the benefit of the blood. The blood will wash and cleanse me. If I sin, I have a propitiation. I have a sacrifice. I have a means of propitiation. There, a means by which all of my sins are cleansed and washed. His blood becomes for me that continual outpouring of God's mercy, cleansing and washing me. If we walk in the light as he's in the light, that's what the blood does. Overwhelms us with the goodness of God, overwhelms us with the proof of the established covenant so that all the benefits are ours. You know, I know you got your hand on Romans 5:10. I'll get there in a minute. The Lord's always correcting me about what scripture we're supposed to turn to. You know, hallelujah. Aren't you glad I'm not just stuck with a piece of paper going, oh, Lord, we'll get to your points later. Let me get through mine. Romans 3 and chapter 3 and verse 24, being justified freely by his grace. Father, we ask you right now, work a miracle for whatever's going down over there.
Amen.
Cause those people to cry out to you. Let there be somebody on the sidewalk who just got out of church who knows you. Who's bold about you. Say, move out of the way, I got the remedy up here.
Amen.
It's about time God's people start taking their place and quit acting like Israel in the days of Saul, hiding behind the rocks and trembling in the caves.
Amen.
About time some Davids rise up around here.
Amen.
Some people with God's own heart. The Lord said, I'm going to find myself someone after my own heart. And God come gave you and I his own heart. We've been given a new heart. It's his heart. Go ahead and walk in his boldness. To have his confidence. To have his bravery. To have his tenaciousness. To not be afraid of anything.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Quit running from your fear. Quit running from the threats of the enemy, the lies of Satan. Get over into the communion. You don't feel like you're in the holies of holies? Have some communion. Have yourself some fellowship. Because the blood is the means of my fellowship. The blood is the means of my communion with the Father. It's how I'm able to draw nigh unto him. It's how I'm able to enter in boldly into the holies of holies. Where angels cover their veil, I have an unveiled face. Where angels veil their face, rather, I have an unveiled face. So do ramanda sikesti. I accommodate nothing. I refuse and reject everything, hands down, except for God. I mean, I want to make sure people understand that. God accepts no man's person. I'm not going to mingle and mix it up with all the other opinions by just standing there agreeing with the lie. Watch out. You got to watch it happen. It's a spiritual thing. You might just say you're trying to be nice and accommodating. It's a spiritual thing. You're submitting your spirit to things that are antichrist, that are not of God. Watch yourself. Watch yourself. Just be silent. Don't nod. Don't agree. Just be silent. Be going off saying all their nonsense. Don't agree. Don't high-five the devil. Come on, give me a break. I don't care how close they are. I mean, many of you about ready to have your families come around. Yeah, I love you, families, but don't high-five their lies. Don't high-five their demon power. Don't high-five the ungodliness. Are you listening to me? Don't agree with the thing that is going to destroy their soul in hell. All you do is just fortify the demon spirits in their life. God anointed us to run the devil off of their life. The authority behind that is the blood. Yeah, we move in this by the name of Jesus Christ. It is by His name. But our authority to be able to utilize His name is the fact that the blood is the means by which Satan has to listen to us. Huh? Because otherwise we'll be like the seven sons of Sceva. Get beat up by the devil. Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. But you're not washed in the blood. You are hurting now. I'm going to beat you up. The blood is the means by which Satan has to listen, hallelujah, to the authority of the name of Christ Jesus in our lives. There's nothing so wonderful as His privilege to be able to fellowship with God, to be able to be filled with the Spirit, to be able to commune with the Lord, to hear Him, to flow in this anointing. The means by it is the blood. That's when we take a hold of the table. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about the means by which all we have to do is recognize what God has done for us through the provision of Christ Jesus at Calvary, and that this should immediately result in fellowship. All you have to do is just say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood that cleanses me. Thank you for your body that was broken so that I can enter into the holiness of holies. Thank you for your broken body that is the means by which I'm healed. Thank you for the children's bread, which is the means of healing. Thank you, Lord, for this manna. Evermore give me this bread of life to eat, this water to drink. You should be right over in the holies of holies if you weren't it before. For he says, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a bloody sacrifice for us. The propitiation of His blood through faith, to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, a bloody sacrifice for us, an offering. Hallelujah. 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 Moshikana Mateya. Oh, to begin to be overcome with the revelation of what He's done for us, the love that He commended towards us, His passion about us, that He would go through such things. He would go through a passion. That's His passion about us. His intent towards us. If God spared not His own Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all, how shall He not also by Him freely give us all things? It is the means by which we're confident that He's going to freely give us all things, because we look at the communion. We look at the means by which we step into the fellowship. That's, I'm holding up the means by which I have fellowship. There's nothing which I've done, no works which I've done, not at the beginning and not now. Not because of anything that we've done, but because of His great love wherewith He loved us. While we were yet dead in our trespasses and sins, He commended His love for us, and Christ died for the ungodly. I believe the seeing of it, the knowing of it, the revelation of it, it works within us such a consecration to God, such a separation to God, that we would never trample underfoot the blood of Jesus Christ. We would always see ourselves as sacred, because what the purchase price of our salvation, the means by which we were brought into the family, how we were delivered from death and from sin, the power of the tyranny and the claim of Satan that he held over us. When man sinned, Romans 5 is devoted to it, but when man sinned, The heavens changed. Creation changed. Satan took over. Death reigned. Death reigned. Death reigned over all mankind from Adam to Moses. God was able to interrupt it for a small group of people so that death could not reign for a small group of people under a covenant who would keep the covenant. But their hearts were stiff, hard, and their necks were stiff. They were stiff-necked. They wouldn't respond to the yoke. They wanted to do their own will, defiantly doing their own will. You know, there was nobody who emphasized what that meant to have an uncircumcised heart, a stiff neck like Stephen. And I believe it's like Acts 7:51. If it's not 51, it's right around in there. He said, he described what it meant to be stiff-necked and uncircumcised of heart. He says, you always resist the Holy Ghost. That's the definition of being stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart. I mean, uncircumcised in heart. You resist the Holy Ghost. I want to be so sensitive to him. Yes. The blood, the beautiful thing about it is the blood and the Holy Ghost witness to the same thing, fellowship and communion. Our fellowship in the Holy Ghost is likened also unto this cup of communion. He became the propitiation through faith in his blood. Think about this. What if you don't have faith in the blood? What if you've got faith in other things? What if you don't recognize the power of the blood? It's through the blood of his cross that he reconciled all things. He reconciled you. He changed you. Through the blood of his cross, he spoiled principalities. He paralyzed them from the eyebrows down. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. He stripped them of his power. What if there's not faith in the blood? I look at people that go to church and I recognize they don't have faith in the blood. I believe that everybody here, based upon what you already know and the fellowship and relationship that you have faith in the blood, but God wants you to have a deeper relationship. He wants you to have a relationship that's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Not just every once in a while. Not a spotty, not like T-Mobile cell phone or some off-brand cell phone. Can you hear me now? I'm just saying it's so spotty. I mean, I heard two words and it was important, but now I can't get through. Climb up in a tree, steal nothing. Father wants a communion, a continuous communion going on. The more you allow the communion to go on, the greater the revelation and understanding, the more real these things become to us. They aren't something that just kind of, that's just off in the distance as the pastor, the minister is trying to explain to us the things that God has done for us. The love that he's committed towards us. As they begin to describe in lofty terms the things that the Spirit of God would try to reveal to your heart, you're only going to understand it just so well until you begin to participate with it, until that relationship is something that is continual, ongoing. You're not going to allow anything to displace it, get in its way. You become violent, full of the zeal of the Lord, full of a zeal for his house. This is his house, his temple, his dwelling place. Not letting anything else occupy it. Faith in his blood. He's the propitiation. God has set him forth to be the propitiation, the mercy seat, the means by which all of our sins and all of our wrongdoing and all of our iniquity and every claim of sin and death is broken through faith, the faith in his blood. When we look in the Old Testament, we find out there was really very few people that really had faith in the blood of the sacrifices that they were offering. It got so bad in the days of Isaiah, he said, your sacrifices is like cutting off the head of a pig. It has no value to me. You lost all faith in its meaning. You lost all faith in what it represents. He says to us, and then this is because when I read these things, what I want you to see and what I want you to visualize is the fact that his blood literally brought his life into us and our life into him, to where we find ourselves living out in him, where if you dwell in me, in other words, I'm living in him. And you go, ooh, you know, I don't want you in me. I'll come over in you, but kind of thing. He's so washed us. He's so cleansed us. He's so made us everything that's holy and acceptable. Not by anything that we did, but because of faith in the blood. Because we have faith in the love that was poured out for us. We have faith in what he championed for us. He came and got us out of prison. We're just standing there looking at him. He says, come go with me. When we read these things, just see it is the means and the honor of the blood, the honor of the communion is that is oneness with them. The honor of the communion is the new covenant, which is oneness with them. What did this ratify? This ratified the new covenant. What does it symbolize that it ratified? The new covenant. What is the new covenant? New heart, new spirit. His laws written in way, his words and ways written in our minds, in our hearts. The new creation, the new creature, the new man, the divine nature. His family, temple of the Holy Ghost, God living in us, walking in us, dwelling. This is what he's saying with these things. This is what he's saying. This is the excitement about it. This is the faith in it. This is the place where Satan is absolutely shut down. These are the things that this is how you need to think. This is how you need to act. This you need to apply. Hallelujah. His blood to your life. You need to be willing to apply. His blood to your lost family members.
Amen.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Because the Lord's made us priests, ministers before him. Hallelujah. And it's with his blood that we minister and by his blood that we able to give to that person in darkness and sin and sickness and disease. The liberation from the stronghold of Satan in their life. Because of the authority that is in the name of Jesus Christ that has been established in our life by what he did to his redeeming sacrifice. And he says here to us, to declare, I tell you. First of all, he says, for the remission of sins which are past. For the complete erasing, faith in the blood says that his sins and my sins and iniquities he remembers no more. That's what faith in the blood. Faith in the blood says, I remember my sins and iniquities no more. Satan comes along with it. I've got weapons of my warfare. First and foremost, it's the word of God. Shut up. You know, you a liar. I can tell it's you. It's not the Holy Ghost because he don't remember any of that stuff.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Come on, you listen to me. Faith in the blood results in the remission of sins which are past. To declare, I say to you, the righteousness of God. To declare, I say at this time, to declare at this time his righteousness, that he might be just in the justifier of him which believes in Jesus. Where is boasting? Excluded. He did it all for you and me. Why don't you get excited about that?
Yeah.
The next time you're trying, you got stuck in some kind of performance-based relationship, just shut down the boasting and say, where's boasting? Yeah. Now, I want you to get over here with me now to Romans chapter 5 and verse 10. I want you to get this. I want you to get it where you can apply it. Amen. You need to bore a shipande. You need to be able to look at your family members this week and say, if you don't have faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, You're not going to make heaven. You can keep it as positive as you want. You're not going to make heaven. Faith in the blood of Jesus Christ shut down hell, Satan, sin, and death. Everybody should be interested, especially in the shutting down of death and torment. Hello. I want you to be able to have it applied to your life so it shut down in you. Sickness has no hold on me.
Amen.
Crushed his head at Calvary.
Amen.
Sickness, the power of sickness was broken at Calvary.
Yeah.
Satan ate, once again, Jesus God anointed Jesus with Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. God was with him. And that was fully manifested when he went to the cross and bearing our body, his body, our sins on the tree, so that we might be made the righteous and being cut off from sin, might be made the righteousness of God in him, by whose wound we were healed. It's the redemption. Satan, his power, his strongholds of death was broken there. Sickness was broken there. Satan is a rebel. He don't agree with God. He's not submitted to God. He's going to come and try to impose upon you and lay on you everything that he himself desires to. He don't see any no trespassing sign. He's an imp. He's the rebel against God. He hates you. He wants to curse you. It's only because you know the Word of God and the authority of the Word of God and the thing, and you have faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, that he's not able to impose that stuff on you. Hey, look, I'll tell you right now, maybe it's true, and I'm sure it is, because God says so. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. I haven't been really experiencing that. That's why I say maybe. I kind of like Old Testament. But I tell you right now, the Lord, and maybe that is something that you just really feel, that you really relate to that scripture. Well, let me help you relate to it better. He delivers us from them all. Jesus said, New Covenant, you shall have tribulation in this world. I understand that. But be a good cheer.
Yeah.
What does that mean to be? What does that mean? Be super happy.
Happy.
Yeah, it means super happy.
Super happy.
Hallelujah. I've overcome the world.
Amen.
He overcame it.
Yeah.
He broke his stronghold. He broke his power. He stripped Satan all principalities of anything that they can impose against us in any realm of sin and sickness and disease and torment. It's about time we understand the basis of that authority that has just legislated to us. It is a ruling from on high. God did it. He changed it. It's past tense. He changed it. Heaven and earth, the day that the blood was spilled. That's why it's a cup of rejoicing. That's why we get excited. Hallelujah. That's why on that day, we're all going to be screaming, ah, redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. He loosed us from our sins in his own blood. Where is boasting? Wherever you did something. Well, did you hear what I did? Shut up! Ain't nobody, I tell you right now, ain't nobody, anybody saying, did you hear what I did? John looked and saw that there was no one, not in heaven, not in earth, not under the earth, no one in the universe who had the right to open the book and loose the seals. And he began to weep, began to sob. It's forever lost. We're forever undone. We're forever separated. There's no one worthy. Behold the Lamb. Behold the Lamb. Behold the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's prevailed. He prevailed. He prevailed in the garden. He prevailed when no one was there to stand with him in his greatest hour of need. He prevailed when everybody betrayed him and ran away. He prevailed. He prevailed. The more you have communion, the more we grab a hold of this, the more we touch it, the stronger it becomes in our lives. It may not produce that great of a shout, but it will produce that great of power. Oh, hallelujah. 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 The blood is the means by which when you speak the name of Jesus Christ, every devil in hell trembles and must obey.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Just as though Christ Jesus himself was speaking to them right now. Right now. Not in this earthly ministry. It was powerful then. But right now. Father has exalted him above all powers, principalities, powers, and might. And Jesus looks at us and says, hey, come, you're here with me. Father exalted him, giving him a name above every name. far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion, because of the change that took place by the redeeming blood that was poured out at Calvary. Through the blood of his cross, he reconciled all things unto himself, both that are in heaven and that are in earth. You think about it now. He says, I want you to come over here. Sit down with me in my victory. Sit down with me. I'll give you the victor's crown as though you did it. And you need to do nothing but believe. But by your believing, I make you a part of everything that I did, so that you're crucified with me, so that you're buried with me by baptism into my death. Maybe you get into this, you're not going to be afraid of ISIS. Oh, it's a Trojan horse. Hey, guess what? We're not Troy. And we don't worship that idol. Thus it has no power over us. Huh? We are a beacon of the gospel, a nation that was raised up by God to preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, blessed and empowered by God to step in to the great revivals that have been seen here, that was seen here, not other nations, here, started here, right here. The great awakening of the 1700s shook the nations of the earth. It happened here. The great awakening of the 1800s didn't happen in other nations. Happened here. Shake the nations. It redefined what church is. It redefined the movings of God. The Azusa Street Revival didn't happen in other nations. Happened here. It shake the nation. It shaped the understanding of the revelation of God. Father's not done yet. Father's not. Satan! You listen to me, you foul spirit of hell. God's not done. Amen. It's not time for you to move in. Amen. It's about time God's people say, Satan comes and he has nothing in me. Amen. I've got total authority over him. Amen. By the blood of Jesus Christ, by the authority of the name of Jesus, by my surrender and obedience to God, I'm not allowing anything except for heaven to have dominion over my attitudes. Amen. Your attitudes are very important. Your attitudes express the condition of your heart. Your appetites are very important. They express the condition of your heart. Your passion, very important, expresses the condition of your heart. Your emotions, very important. They need to be subjected to the Spirit of the Lord. They need to be brought into check. You need to tell your body what it's going to do. You need to tell your person how you're going to feel. You need to tell you how you're going to think.
Amen.
It's about time you let God's word rule. He has exalted his word above his name. You and I should exalt his word above our opinions.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Some of you, I'm just going to have a shout and praise. I'm thinking about having a school of shouting and praise. I am. I'm thinking about it. I'm thinking about just having it. I got a couple of people I've already identified. I want to make them disciples of shouting and praise. I don't usually pick out the people who the power of God's moving on them. They're doing fine on their own. I pick out the people who's got nothing happening. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
I heard people say, well, you don't want to do that because it doesn't really build faith in the meeting. You get the people who the power of God's already moving on them, you touch them and they go doing backflips and faith goes to all-time high. That may be so, but I've still watched too many people that didn't have the power of God moving on them still walking out the door without anything. I'm ministering the way God put it on my heart. I'm looking for the people who don't have a move of God. Just said that we can get a move of God. Those people don't know how to shout and praise. I need to just bring them into a meeting and say, okay, begin to shout and praise right now. I want you to shout as loud as you can, Jesus. And we'll just work on it till we get that their emotions unplugged. God dug a deep well and the Philistines come plugged it up. We gotta shout that stuff out.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, all those foul thoughts of the past can't stand in the midst of shout. All of those intimidating lies can't stand in the midst of shout. All that sense of failure and shame. No, it's one of the chief, don't think it's strange, it's one of the chief things that Satan does. He comes and tries to make everybody feel like a failure. That's what he does. He accuses everybody, you failure.
Yeah.
You blow it. You can do nothing right. You just got to rise up and say, shut up. You foul spirit of hell. You lying force of darkness. You have no right to be talking to me. Out of here. It won't take too many times and you'll begin to understand the weapons of your warfare, which are not carnal but mighty. Because you did it by the authority of what God said in His Word and by the authority of the Spirit. Because you just, come on, man. Sit there and agree with it. Yeah. Here I got this bigger stick. Beat me for a while. Let me help you. I can tell you some things you don't even know. God, Jesus, please, dear people, God wants you to be filled with the Spirit so you can have boldness and confidence and certainty. Father wants you to be certain about the anointing that has been given you, greater anointing than Elijah had. Whoa, the anointing of Jesus Christ, the anointing of the Son, the only begotten Son of God. My, when you begin to believe that about yourself, oh my. Mind the radical changes will take place. You'll begin to do stuff, say stuff, speak stuff in God that you never imagined yourself. You'll begin to see miracles, signs, and wonders. You'll begin to see the activity of the Holy Ghost through your life that you've been longing to have, and it was always there, waiting for the moment of your agreement, the moment where you would be willing to rise up and be what God created you to be and do what God created you to be. God placed within the heart of David an unwillingness to sit and listen to the threats of Goliath and the enemies of the people of God. God filled him with such a zeal of authority and insight for who he was and the people that he belonged. We the people of God. How can this be going on? God is our God. Father will work that same grace in you. He'll work that same grace in you. When he sees a willingness, when he sees you in the midst of it, when your heart is being willing to respond to the sensitive heart that he made so that you can understand how to function and cooperate with that which pleases him and refuse and resist those things which grieve him. The blood of Jesus Christ fully loosed us from every influence of the devil, every influence of the satanic, every influence of the power of death, so that we may be confident that those things that are going on are of God in our life. Hallelujah. That those the devil never inspired you to go set the captives free. A house divided against itself cannot stand. He never inspired you to go lay down your life on the mission field. I'm wondering if this is my own mind or if this is God. It's God. And it should be your own mind now that you have the mind of Christ, the mind of God, the mind of the Spirit. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Suto non bo keton bo ramanea. Halamonga she kanamondea. You know, I begin to commune with Father. See, the blood of Jesus Christ allows me to draw near unto Him, to come into the holies of holies, to be able to stand before Him like Jesus did on the Mount of Transfiguration. Huh? You start standing there in the presence of the Lord like that with that kind of confidence and you're going to be transfigured. You're going to start brightening up. You're going to start lightening up. Hallelujah. You're going to start shining. How about Sanaya? I'm looking for worship to go to the place that Father's calling us to come. Father doesn't want to leave you out. I mean, it'd be one thing, we all up in heaven worshiping, we done forgot where you at. Everybody's sitting there going, what are they singing now? We're singing the song of the Spirit. Sing too. But I've got to know the Holy Ghost. He's here for you right now. He's come and He freely pours out all that He has upon anybody who desires. All for the asking, not for the earning. All for the asking, not for the deserving. All for the asking, because He freely gave. He freely gives. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You're looking at Romans 5:10 with me? I have to stop. I have to try to keep from looking at so many amazing verses of Scripture to try to just sit down on this verse of Scripture for you just a second. I try to be thoughtful of the fact that Chris is going to work on a math problem all night. When he told me that, I said, Lord, I ask you to give him a wise and understanding heart so he don't have to work on that thing all night. And of course, he's already brilliant. You know what? The Lord just make you more brilliant, because thinking doesn't come in the realm of the mind, comes in the realm of the spirit anyways. And if it wasn't all, your spirit wasn't all clogged up with all that nonsense, you'd be the brightest person on the planet. God's people should be the most brilliant people. Daniel and those that were with him were the most brilliant people on the planet, because their spirit was right. Hallelujah. It wasn't clogged up and twisted by all the demonic influence of guilt and shame. They knew who they were, people of God. Chosen, special,
amen.
Elect,
amen.
People, the chosen.
Yes. Hallelujah.
The last thing that Satan wants you to believe about yourself is that you, the chosen, the special, the elect, a treasured people, a royal nation, a holy priesthood, those who living and dwelling in the presence of Almighty God with the same authority of the only begotten Son of God, the King of Heaven. Come on. You start believing things about that, you all of a sudden your spirit's not going to be all clogged up, and you'll think a lot better than you've been thinking. You'll learn a lot better than you've been learning. You'll have wisdom, a wise and understanding heart.
Amen.
It's the grace of God. God gave Solomon a wise and understanding heart that he may know every mystery. The most brilliant person on the face of the earth, a grace of God, a gift, cause your spirit to be right. Has nothing to do with how many brain cells you have in your head. Has nothing to do. It doesn't work that way. How much memory you can retain in your messenger RNA. It don't work that way. It don't work that way.
It
did not rasiki, don't no mositea. All lies, don't work that way. Hallelujah. You are already the most brilliant people on the face of the earth because you know God. God has given you an understanding to know Him. That's better than knowing all the secrets of the universe and being able to solve the greatest problems man has ever come up with. It's a higher knowledge still to know Him. He's given us an understanding that we may know Him.
Amen.
And His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, whom He sent. Why don't you get focused on that kind of insight, that kind of knowledge? Hallelujah. Why don't you start working those equations? Hallelujah. Why don't you start applying that wisdom and that understanding? His blood, it makes me everything that I am. His body, it's made me everything that I am. It gives me all of my fellowship. It's all my right to come in. It's nothing to do with anything that I've done. Trusting in the blood of Jesus Christ, depending upon, leaning upon Him, having your confidence and faith in that which He's done, results in an entirely different relationship. No matter where you stand, no matter how mature you are, no matter how grown up you are in God, no matter how much you fail, no matter what your weaknesses are, gives you an entirely different standing. So the Lord says to us here in Romans 5:10, look at what He says. Okay, tonight we're going to show forth His death. He says this: for when we were enemies, we were reconciled, changed. Say changed.
Changed.
Changed. Changed. Reconciled to God. Changed to be made acceptable to God. Say changed to be made acceptable to God.
Changed.
So much so that He says, we won. There's no difference between us. Come on in. There's no spot. There's no blemish. Not just once a year. Continue to come in and remain. Come on in here. Come live over here. Come, let me show you all the glory. Let me show you everything that I've done since before the beginning. Come here. Let me reveal the fullness of who I am to you. There's everything that is going on against the Word of God, the Spirit of God in your life, is Satan trying to shut this down, trying to stop it. Don't listen to his lies anymore.
Amen.
Don't be stopped anymore. It doesn't, all that stuff doesn't matter. What you did don't matter. What Jesus did, that's what matters.
Amen.
What you did it wouldn't get you 1 second with the Almighty. What He did allows you to come and remain there forever.
Hallelujah.
He purchased eternal redemption for us. By the blood. By the blood and by the blood alone. Our sins and iniquities He remembers no more. I'm going to tell you again. By the blood and by the blood alone. By what Jesus did at Calvary is the means by which our sins and iniquities He remembers no more. By the blood alone is the means by which the power of death that was held over us because of Adam's sin was completely broken off of us with no claims forever. That does deserve a shout. It makes me shout every day. That's the source of my shout. So I said, what makes you so happy, so confident? Blood. I mean, come on. I mean, don't you have some times of failing and tripping up? And doesn't that overwhelm you? Blood. I just have His blood. I just go to the blood. The blood washes me, cleanses me. It's the means by which every claim of Satan that would say, I got you down. No, you don't. Blood. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. You've washed me, cleansed me. Amen. You got nothing. Ah. So I say, Satan comes, he has nothing in me. Why can I say that? How can I say that? Blood. So I say, how can you say you the righteousness of God?
Blood.
The blood! Somebody said, how can you say you're holy and acceptable unto God?
The blood!
Blood! The blood!
Thank you, Lord.
The precious blood. The blood. The blood.
Blood.
Nothing but the blood.
Amen.
Oh, the blood. Oh, Jesus. Oh, the blood. Oh, Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus that washes white as snow, that washed my sins away. What a different kind of thinking you have. What a different kind of consciousness you have. What a different kind of confidence and certainty you have. What an uninhibited embrace that you have of all that Father has provided. You don't draw back because of unbelief and say, I'm not worthy. You embrace that which is freely given because you're captivated by He who is worthy. He alone is worthy to take the book. And loose the seals. He alone has loosed us from our sins and washed us in His blood, His own blood. Washed in His own blood. I said washed. Faith in the blood of Jesus. Faith from the rising of the sun till it goes down. Faith when you're up and when you're down. Faith when you're great and when you're small. Faith when you're big and when you're little. Faith in the blood. I won't have faith or confidence in anything that I've done. When there be any boasting, it's excluded. I have no additional rights or access to God because of any other thing that I've done or because of faithful living or anything. It's blood. It's blood. It's just the more I walk with God in obedience and faithfulness, the more I understand what He's done. And the more I lay hold on it and Satan can't get in. And because if I give him in place, he pushes me that much harder and harass me that much more. And I'm constantly living battle weary. Make him battle weary. Hallelujah. You listen to me. You make the devil battle weary. You walk around the rest just fresh. He's all battle weary and you fresh. They that wait upon the Lord renew their strength. Amen. We fresh. Hallelujah. Slap him again. He's battle weary. He's battle weary. And we're fresh. Amen. For if when we were enemies, when you were enemies, God did this. What do you think he's going to do for you now? Now that you're friends. Now that you're beloved children. Now that you're heirs of God and joint. Now that you're known of God, known by God, the issue of God, born of the Spirit, born of His Word. Come on. If when we were enemies, He reconciled us to God by the death of His Son. Tonight, when we take a hold of the blood, what we do is we show forth the death. The death is the means of our life. The death of Christ Jesus is the means that we stepped out of the power of death. If He did all of this for us, when we were enemies, by His death, much more now being reconciled. How much more now that we're reconciled shall we be saved by His life? What he's living, He ever lives to make intercession for us. The life that was transferred to us and imparted to us, because where the blood is applied, the Holy Ghost comes and moves and makes a new creation and resides on the inside. Wherever the blood is, it's made perfectly holy. Trying to skip. No, I can't look at those in any of those verses because I'll just get stuck and won't ever get out of them. Go quickly over to Colossians. Let me just show you a couple of verses of scripture over there that I'm going to try not to get stuck in. Because I'm telling you right now, Colossians chapter 1 and Colossians chapter 2 sends me over into orbit of praise, into orbit of grace, into the orbit of this is unimaginable faith-building word of God that says, look at who I am in Him. In Him. In Him. I don't even see me. I see Him. That's why I'm so untouchable. I'm in Him. You can't touch me. Try to get at me. Are you doing this? I'm getting at you. No, you're not. You're touching Jesus. You can't get me. I'm in Him. I just hit you. No, you didn't. I'm in Jesus. I got where you at. No, you don't even see me. I'm in Jesus. You're in Jesus. You are in Him. He made you a home in Himself. Through His blood and through His Amen. Body. Even as drink and bread sustains our natural life, His body and His blood sustains our spiritual life. Hallelujah. And He gave to us His body for food continually. And He gave to us His blood for drink continually. Isn't that amazing? Yes. Jesus. We can't lose here. Amen. He obtains for me eternal redemption.
Yes.
Hallelujah. You know, I just love those words of Paul, elect. According to the foreknowledge of God, by sanctification of the Spirit and the washing of the blood of Jesus Christ. Mando zeke na masate. Ekido monjange karamonjikasta remenge iko shikari. Mondande. Thank you, Lord. This is Hamonde Rese. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. This is your source of shouting and thanksgiving and rejoicing. Don't forget it. Please, just don't forget. You know, I'm just trying to turn to Colossians, and I got stuck over here looking at Ephesians 2:16. I happened upon the page. It was an accident, on purpose. And I love this verse of scripture because what he did in the body of his own flesh, what he did, it says, in one body by the cross. He's slain. He slew the enmity. He slew. He destroyed the power that made us other than God, that made us different from Him, that kept us being apart from the covenant and the promises. The scripture says He abolished death. He abolished death. He brought revelation. He brought life and immortality to light. Or He brought revelation of life and immortality to you and me. I'm walking around over here in the God life. He's given us by His divine power everything that pertains unto life and godliness. He brought to us this wonderful life and immortality. He through death. Tonight we show forth His death. He through death destroyed him that had the power of death. That is the devil. People, I could stand here perhaps tonight and tell you great testimonies of great feats in God. But I'm sorry. I think the greatest testimony of any great feats in God is what Jesus did. What God did. I mean, I just am so captivated by what He did. I think we should all be in shock about what He did and not so fascinated about what somebody that's serving Him did. I think our testimony should be weak in comparison to the testimonies of what Christ Jesus did being declared.
Amen.
We're going to get this. Listen to me. We're going to get this. Listen to me. We're going to get this.
Amen.
Because God knows how to help our getter get it. I'm going to tell you right now. He knows how to work with us until we do get it. All we have to do is keep coming back. All we've got to do is say, I want this. I want to get this. I failed. I've done wrong. I've missed it. I've thought out of my own mind. Try to do things out of my own strength. But I'm here to learn. I want this, Lord. I want this. And He doesn't look at us with an impatient, you know, disdain. Oh, okay. Like, oh, I'm going to give you another chance. He's into it. He loves us. He's committed. He's consecrated to us. Hallelujah. Colossians chapter 1, verse 20. Mando restedi alamast. People, I just published on the internet, on our website, my translation of Ephesians with commentary. I challenge you to try to get through it in a year. I challenge you to study it. Study the commentary. Somebody said, I just can't study on my own. Find somebody to study with you. Study. Get through it. It will impact your life in a radical way. There's a lot of scripture references there. I'm going to spend a lot of time getting after it. Huh? Somebody said that when my translation was done, you could order a Bible, but it's going to take a semi-truck to deliver it to you. That's not true, because there's electronic versions. It's very small. You just click and point. Hallelujah. Andoko saya, maya saya tai, bukana naimpai, mora shambra kayashi. I believe in the washing of the water of the word. He presents unto himself a glorious church by the means of his word being preached, by the means of his word being declared, by the means of his word being rehearsed. He presents unto himself a glorious church. When we are part of a glorious church, get into the word, stay in the, have the word continually there, washing, tambura. Let all of your, the way you process, the way you think, the way you make decisions, let God bring scripture references to you. That's the way it works. Hallelujah. I've been quoting this half the night. You're so good to read it. Colossians 1:20. Hallelujah. I have to read verse 19. For it pleased the Father. I went back all the way up because it's just amazing. I mean, verse 13 sets the pace. I mean, before that, actually. But, I mean, you know, I'm not going to go back there. I refuse to go back. No. It's just all so good. It's also explosive. It's explosive. Exporatane apaya. Ilimakaini ata. Iseratapan. Isonomo. For it pleased the Father that in Christ Jesus should all fullness dwell. And when us, you know, when Paul says that, he says it for a purpose because he wants to, us to see ourselves in him. And we dwell in him. And we are complete in him who is the head. He's already said that. I told you I wasn't going to back up, but I have to. He's trying to help us understand the things that he's already declared. If you just let this, if you let his word have preeminence in your thinking, if you let what he's done for you be the reality by which you have the right. You can either live in those things that are set up in the circumstances and the events of life surrounding you, and you can look upon those things which are seen, or you can choose to look on those things which are unseen and live out your life as has been described by the word. I'm going to tell you right now, you're either living out your life as it's been described by men. Believe me, God didn't set all this up. You can either live your life as it's been described by men, and the caste systems imposed upon different financial groups in America. I can live your life as God described it in his word. If you begin to live your life as God described it in his word, his faith, his glory, his power, his spirit will begin to work through you mightily. All the dynamics change. All the rules change. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You find out that everything that you need and everything that you ask for and everything you want, God sets it up and orders it supernaturally. Everything. Down to the smallest profane stuff. Huh? About the hamburger you're going to eat. It is amazing. I'm telling you, it's amazing. It's amazing. God goes before you. Listen, he's given us the relationship and the ministry that Jesus had. Jesus could have called 12 legions of angels, which if you take in the province of Rome, that would be something like about 6,200, about 6,000 at least per legion. 12 times 6,000. That's a whole bunch. Huh, that's 720,000. How much is it? 7,200,000? 72,000. Okay, well, I just like to make it bigger. But it only takes one. It only takes one. I can call 72,000 angels to help me. They're already helping me. Somebody said that when Jesus reconciled things in heaven and earth, that even the angels who were disdained by what we did against God and the way that we lived in defiance against his splendor and his beauty, that he entrusted with us above them, that suddenly they looked upon us now with love and affection. Definitely extra biblical. But worthy of thought. Huh? Can you hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
Can you hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
Do you know how sacred God made us to be and how profane we became? Yes. You know how holy God made us to be and how demon-possessed we became? How the Father, the authored and created our life, and yet we became so fallen that Satan himself became our dad, but we've been created anew in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
God sent the Creator. God the Father sent the Creator to create us anew.
Amen.
God the Father sent the Creator and humbled himself. Humbled him unto the point of a servant so that he might have a body that was perishable, that he might die for us. So we read here in Colossians 1:20, and having made peace through the blood of his cross. Understand me. You should never live a moment. Don't you let Satan get yourself a cup of communion.
Yeah. Amen.
If Satan tries to bring any kind of division between you and the Lord, make you feel unwanted, unwelcome, unworthy, get the blood. Just get the blood out right there.
Amen.
Get the blood out and how you're, it's come on in.
Amen.
Get the blood out. Get faith in the blood and say it's a done deal and start rejoicing in God for what he's done because it's established forever.
Amen.
Nothing
Amen.
Can change it.
Amen.
Nothing can change it.
Amen.
All the lies of hell cannot change it. All the disbelief and doubt of men cannot change it. Nothing can change it. He's changed everything by the blood of his cross. Everything in heaven and in earth. It's all changed. And you who are sometimes alienated, one time alienated, and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now He's changed you too. He's changed you and made you acceptable to God. He's changed the way that you think. He's changed the way that you behave. He's given you a divine grace. You know, I love reading that verse. I've just been meditating on Abimelech lately. Because he had a perfect heart. And in the perfection of my heart and the innocence of my hand or the cleanness of my hand, I did this thing. And God said, I know that in the perfection of your heart you did it. Thus I restrained you from sin. I grabbed a hold of that and said, lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil. Lord, you can restrain me from sin when you see that I don't want it no more. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
He'll restrain me from every evil thing when he sees all I want is a holy thing. Holy thing. I'll be kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to, I'll be preserved blameless, my spirit, soul, and body. Now, I want you to see that what I'm telling you is getting ready to be spoken here, right here. You who at one time were alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, He's changed you, made you acceptable unto God in the body of His flesh. We're going to take the body of His flesh tonight. This is how it happened. The body of His flesh changed me and made me acceptable unto God and gave me all rights and benefits therewith. Of healing for the body, authority over all the powers of the enemy, oneness of my soul and spirit with His. From enmity to intimacy. From enmity to intimacy. Look at this. In the body of His flesh, look at this. This is what He did. In the body of His flesh, what He did at Calvary, what we're going to partake of tonight in the communion, the elements of that which He did one moment in time, once for all, forever. Now there's no more need of sacrifice for sin anymore, for they've been purged. Look at this. In the body of His flesh through death to present me holy, unblameable, and unreprovable in His sight. I'm telling you, the blood has done a very good work about cleansing me from sin. It's just not kind of, sort of. It is unblameable. It is holy. It is everything. When I'm talking about change to be acceptable to God, it's a complete and total. Look at that. Holy. Say, I'm holy.
I'm holy.
Say, I'm unblameable.
I'm unblameable.
Say, I'm unreprovable. In His sight. Who can lay any charge to God's elect? It's God who is justified or made righteous. Think about it. Somebody said, well, does that mean that there is now no room for correction? No, there's room for correction. Does that mean there's no room for growth and maturity? No, there's room for growth and maturity. And because this is what you've been made, it's a gift. You don't have to make it yourself. God gave you the gift of holiness. He gave you the gift of perfection. He gave you the gift of righteousness. He gave you the gift of purity so that you might grow and mature in it. And you need somebody to point out to you when you're not listening right, when you're not walking by the Spirit, and when you're not walking by the Word. And you shouldn't be offended. Did you hear what I said this morning? Hear what the Holy Ghost is saying? The Lord's been speaking to me on this. He said, so many people cry out to me to hear my word. And then when my word comes, they're offended by it. Because it's not what they were thinking they were going to hear. Hello. Because God's come to make us right. Not to justify our wrong, to make us right. He came to make us right. He made us right. He made us so right. We could never come to this place. No matter what we did, we could never have this place. No matter how perfect we live, no matter how holy we live, we could never be that. We could never fulfill that description of us. Never. You'd never get it. You'd have it for like 10 days and then blow it. At best, you know what I'm saying? You'd just blow it. If Jesus would have sinned one time, all would have been lost. Satan would have been able to he would have been able to move in. And there would have been no one found worthy. but because Jesus stood fast, was a spotless, sinless lamb. Because he stood fast in complete obedience to God and condemned sin in the flesh. He's brought to us a place of sanctuary to where that now we are in him. And we now share his inheritance. We share all of his reward. We share all of his conquest. All of his greatness. All of his goodness. All of his holiness. All of his purity. So that we're kept by the power of God. Through faith. Somebody come over there and start helping me. I'm glad that somebody knows who they are. Used to somebody's. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha! Hallelujah. 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 Are you happy, honey?
I am above happy.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Woo! Undaya. Undabaya nai, say a poor. Bokaranambalaya. Can you imagine how much God blesses people that are so holy and acceptable unto him? Huh? Can you imagine how generous God is with people who are so right with him? And not self-made righteousness. God-made righteousness. Amen. Because of faith in the blood. That's why you can be confident that if he spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all. Hallelujah. He shall now also by him freely give us all things. You know what a wonderful thing is to do? Quit beholding things after your own perceptions. See through that which God has said in his word. You'll see yourself different. You'll see everybody else around you different. You won't know yourself after the flesh anymore. You'll know yourself after the spirit. You won't know yourself all after your faults and failings, but you will know yourself after Jesus and all that he, all that he has purchased, all that he has done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, listen, my wife and I are so proud of Daniel and Summer and Kate and Ruth. I mean, you just don't understand. You just don't even understand. You can't even begin to comprehend how blessed we are. To see what God has done. to see things come under divine order. You can understand someday. Just walk with him. One day you won't have your own filter. You'll have his. One day you won't see life through your rose-colored glasses. But you'll see him through the eyes of the Spirit. And you'll step into miracles and signs and wonders. You'll step into demonstration of the power of God. You'll begin to be blessed on your right hand and your left. And when the enemy comes and tries to destroy you on any level, God brings a restoration as far as it proceeds anything that Satan would ever try to do. We are hot on the trail of destroying all the works of the devil. We don't tolerate anything Satan's done for any reason. You hear me?
Yes.
Care what people think, what you believe, what you do. We end up destroying the works of the devil. When they exposed, we just radically go after them. We don't allow sin in our house. Sin is a reproach to us. Because it's been all the leaven's been removed from off of us, and our heart was made sensitive to that which pleases Father.
Yes.
Before we didn't have any distinction, we couldn't know the difference.
Yes. Right.
You hear what I'm telling you?
Yes.
But when we got a new heart, suddenly knew the difference. And sin became an evil thing. You abhor it. So sensitive to that which grieves. Baby, come up here. Just come stand with me. You don't have to put this on. You're fine. I took a picture the other day. Everybody was standing in a shade. She was shining. I got the picture. You can see it. Shining. Look at that. So full of the Holy Ghost. Baby, you need to start flowing the Holy Ghost, preaching to these people.
Yes.
Telling these people what God is doing. Father's doing some amazing things, isn't he?
He is. He is doing amazing things.
You need, sometimes I'm just going to pry her up out of what's happening. Of course, the Lord's going to do it. But some wonderful things are happening. Sometimes things become so glorious and God's just too sacred to share. Sometimes. Huh? He just loves us so much, Jess. Just loves us so much. This section here, just stand, would you please come? How many, we have plenty of tortillas tonight?
Yes, we have tortillas.
You know, these are good tortillas. Who got these unleavened tortillas? Huh? Huh? Who went and got these unleavened tortillas? Over at Trader Joe's. Better not give me no sloppy tortillas. I want the good ones. I thank God upon every remembrance.
Likewise, Pastor Mark. That's Pastor.
Thank you, honey. Thank you for being such an amazing woman of God. Amen. To the body of his flesh. To the body of his flesh. To present you holy, unblameable. To the body of his flesh. Present you holy, unblameable, and unreprovable. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
That's who you are.
Amen.
I love you so much, Brad. Present you holy, and unblameable, and unreprovable. To so remove our sins and our iniquities that he remembers them no more, church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the great anointing in Brad and Amy's life. Father, we just thank you that you bring them into such great pastoral ministry and anointing in their life. that they just be living out the good life. Father, thank you so much for Daniel and Summy. Oh, you don't know how much we love you, girl. Love you too. Bless you. Praise God for the family, God. Manny, you're looking good, man. Cancer free, Bubba. Hallelujah. Woo! Father, I just thank you for providing a great life in you, great wife in you, lots of kids. Hallelujah. Just wait what God's going to do. You haven't even begun to dream. You just be blessed. Ay, karakosha manea. You're just so blessed. Through the body of his flesh. Through the veil of his flesh. Through the veil. Veil. Noah, hallelujah. Father, thank you for the anointing on Noah. Thank you, Father God, strengthen his little body. Hallelujah. And Wesley, too. Sitara no sipaya. You should never feel unworthy. You should never feel unworthy. For he's made us so worthy. Somebody said, well, I just felt so unworthy. No. When Isaiah felt unworthy, a call from off the altar applied by seraphim was good enough. We received the blood of Jesus Christ applied by him. Wow.
It's a great salvation.
Amen. Just walk around with the bread. Walk around with bread all day long. Just walk around. Go to work. Hey, baby. Lord Jesus, thank you for sweet darling. Here, take this. This is, you can have this. This represents Jesus' body and your healing and my healing. Amen. Good one. Hallelujah. Boda Sunday. Kura Stekara. Sikana Mokadane. Berenaya. Hallelujah. Praise that God, she lied. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for Paul. Paul, we love you, man. Sotani. Suribakish. Thank you, Jesus. Urababastake. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
So kana mande ashiti
yadi tara. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Faith, how are you doing? Praise God.
JJ, love you, buddy.
Love you, buddy. Bless you. Doing good night? Hambra Monti City. See, when you become so confident that you're not to be sick because it was ordained and commanded by God, you don't get sick anymore. I'm just telling you, it's all within the realms of that which He supplied for us, that He's given to us as this gift, this communion, something that was paid for at Calvary. And now upheld, oh, this section, come on. upheld and established by his life. Can you imagine? And Lynn, can you hear me? Jesus defines the meaning of his existence to pray for you. I can't, that is amazing. Can you even imagine? Isn't it wonderful? If he done all this by his death, look at what all he's doing by his life. His death happened once in time in a very, all within about 6 hours. And for the most part, it was over the course of 3 days. He accomplished all of those things in such a simple interval of time. Think of what all he's been doing and continues to do as he's lived for 2,000 years. You come into the shout and rejoicing school of shout. Bless you. You're looking good, man. Nice teeth. Okay. Jack, we love you, man. Look, you know, the first like 10 years that Jack was around, I said, Jack, do you know you're on your way to heaven? He's like, I hope so. No, Jack. Are you on your way to heaven? Jack, are you on your way to heaven?
Man, this right.
Hallelujah. Jack's soul is as important as the President of the United States.
Yes, it is.
Jack's soul is as important as the most famous man that ever lived. Think about it, people. God is long-suffering. He don't see things like we see them. Huh? He's invited us to come see it as he sees it. Amen. You just don't forget about what the body did. Hallelujah. Changes everything about you, the way you think, the way you perceive, the way you respond, your ability to rise up and throw down, cast down those imaginations, those lies and slanders that come at you from the enemy, because God gave you a heart like David to get up and take heads. Yes. I saw this picture today that someone painted, and it had David and up against Goliath. He looked so small, but he was up on top of Goliath. He looked like, this little midget, this little frail human being up against this massive giant. He's up on top of him with a sword, Goliath's sword that was bigger than he was, holding Goliath's head, which is almost as big as half of his body. I'm like, I love that. That's it. That's who we are.
Amen.
Hey, darling Anna, do you know what this represents, baby? Huh? It represents the body of Jesus, doesn't it? Huh? And here, sweetheart, you have this communion because that's the body of Jesus. What does this represent, Missy? Huh? It's the body of Jesus. Here, go ahead, take some. No, you're not supposed to eat yet. Shaden, how are you doing, sweetie? People from Bly. Country people.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just praise God for what's happening in Pastor Brad and Margaret's life. I mean, just the things that are just going through the roof in their life. The more you participate with God, the more you get way, way out there. Way out there. Way out there. Way out. Way out where all the relatives are saying, you are crazy, you're out of your mind, you're ruining your life, you must be under some controlling thing that's some occult. Get way out there. God gives him this great priesthood property, over 130 acres, something like that. She comes here, picks up a Suburban, looks better than mine for $1,700. I mean, come on, $1,400. Provision. Provision, isn't that great? God is good.
He is.
He is wonderful. Hala monje kaya. Father, we just thank you for putting your blessing on Daryl. Hallelujah. Use him. Robin Hood. Hallelujah. Shikata. Mighty man of God.
Amen.
Chaplain of the football team. Amen. Father, thank you for the anointing. Hallelujah. Just so bold and so confident in the Holy Ghost. Just so deserving and so worthy because it's all in Jesus. That's the body of his flesh. Amen. We love you guys so much. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yippee. I don't see John Neth anymore. I see Jesus. John Neth doesn't live. Christ Jesus Christ. See, this is the fellowship of love. We're breaking God's great love for us. He loved us so much. This is just love. Atmosphere gets supercharged with love. It's why it's called the love feast. So it's called the love feast. God so loved the world, the gay, only begotten Son, that if anyone believes, they would not perish, but have everlasting life. The greatest words you can tell to anybody, to your family, they ask you to pray at Thanksgiving. Just open up and say, Father, we thank you that you loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe would not perish, would have everlasting life. And I thank you that you promised me that if I would turn my life over to you, that I would be saved and my house. Amen. Look, I'm making this prayer simple. This is going to be Holy Ghost filled prayer. I take it as the word of God, and it's said in obedience, and God's going to move through it.
Amen.
And you can remember every word of that because that's scripture. Watch what God will do. I pray this be the greatest Thanksgiving that you've ever experienced, that you've ever had. And we're going to give you another opportunity to get warmed up on Wednesday night because we're going to do the same thing. How are you doing, my little brother? We love you very much. Bless you. Hey, Two Fingers. He's quite the character. He's quite the little guy. You're blessed. Are you blessed? Huh? Do you have anything to complain about? Well, I'm glad to hear that. And no, you don't. And when you step over into faith and you don't allow the complaint will be a thief that will rob you from God's blessing and miracle. I don't care what miracle you need. It does not matter what miracle. It doesn't matter what miracle. Look. Just know you no longer live. It's no longer about you. You're just as qualified as anyone else because it's in Jesus that you find your life. Now, in the name of Jesus, every stronghold of your mind, everything that you've allowed to occupy your thinking that has made it about you, no more. Hallelujah. Who's crying? Bring the baby here. Oh, hey, bless you, bless you.
Bless you too.
That baby hadn't been in church enough.
I just want to let you know I love you, man.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I love you too. I'm glad you're here. You guys take care of him.
Amen.
You guys get around him and take care of him. So you too busy. Hey, you need to be in church more. Hey, sweet baby. Hey, sweet baby. We love you. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Say, Mama, you got to bring me to church more. It just ain't even right. Well, you ain't coming here. This is the best church. But this is the Holy Ghost church. They can't be out doing this over at Miramar, otherwise I'd go over there. Love you, sweetie. It's just always blessed to see you. But I'm not kidding. Oh, come on, I'll say a talk. How are you doing, Bill? Oh, bless you, man. Through the body of his flesh. To present you holy, unblameable, unreprovable. So that you so fall in love with such a position and place in God, and acceptance in the Beloved, that you give yourself holy to it. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, and he knew that everybody was going to abandon him, he took the bread. And lifting it up towards heaven, he blessed it. He blessed the bread and he said, Father, O God of heaven, thank you for the bread that you've given to us. And then he said, hey, baby. Love you, sweet darling, so much. This is my body, which is broken for you. This represents the wounds and the stripes that I will receive. This is like that bread of affliction that you made in haste when you came up out of Egypt, when Father delivered you with a strong and mighty hand. But now you're going to be delivered from sin and death, because I'm going to go to the cross for you and I'm going to be broken. The face bread, the bread of his presence, the bread of the covenant, the healing bread, the manna, the true manna, the bread of life. I am the bread of life, Jesus said. If any man eats this bread, if any man takes this bread, takes a hold of the covenant of the bread of the covenant, shall live forever. Amen. We thank you, Jesus, for your body. That destroyed the power of death. That destroyed the power of sin. That delivered us from every power of darkness and claim of hell. Your body that has presented us now, holy and blameless and unreprovable. Amen. Food indeed. I was hungry. Food. Bogalamaya. Mayaha. Tortillas never taste as good as they do at communion. Hallelujah. This is my fellowship.
Yes.
When I feel distant, or when the enemy's trying to come in like a flood and something trying to prevent me, this is my fellowship. This is how I enter in. This is get the communion. This is the communion. It's my entrance in. It's I begin to thank him for the body and for the blood. Man, that's good, ain't it? Those are handmade tortillas. Hallelujah. He, in his own body, he bore our sins in his own body on the tree. So that we might be cut off from sin. He, through his own body, through the death of his own body. I pray that you grab a hold of it. It's yours. It's yours. Own it. Own it. Own it. Own this great salvation. Own this great redemption. I said, here it is. New covenant. In my blood. A covenant cannot be established until there's the death of the testator, the sacrifice. So this establishes this, the blood of the everlasting covenant. The blood of the everlasting covenant. The blood of the new covenant. That is given to erase, remove, destroy, eliminate every sin. Refreshing, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
Satisfying, eh?
Yes.
Ain't no leaven in this. There ain't no sour, bitter wine tasting this. This is juice. It's the fruit of the vine that hadn't been spoiled. Amen.
Amen.
Ain't no rotten fruit of the vine. Amen.
Amen.
Some people came to me, tried to serve me communion one time with wine, fermented wine. I said, I'm not taking communion with leaven. He looked at me and said, yeah, that is right. Wine is leaven, isn't it? I said, yeah, it is. So you got unleavened bread and leavened wine. What a mixture. Go get some juice and we'll have communion. We're going to keep the communion, the fellowship, without any leaven.
Praise God. Amen.
Spiritually, we're going to be a new lump. We're a new lump. It's going to stay. And if any leaven tries to creep on you, just take the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Everybody stand with me. How many of you love everybody in the place? Thank you, Jesus. Come worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings and with all the first fruits of your increase. Let God just bless you. Just let Him bless you. Just give. Somebody said, I've been giving. Well, go ahead and give more. I want to break off the yoke now tonight. Listen, I'm going to break off the yoke tonight. Anything that's yoking up your finances, that's hindering the flow of provision and the blessing of God. Father said, I will make you wealthy that I might establish my covenant. Or I give you wealth that I might establish my covenant. We're living in a greater one right now. And you've been blessed with the riches of heaven spiritually. And as a consequence, there's a riches in every dimension coming your way. I break the power of lack. I break the power of lack. I break the power of lack right now in Jesus' name. I break the power of lack. That there's an abundance provision. That there's a generous provision in your life flowing through you. Hallelujah. Let me just tell you this, dear people, you want to make it a point to always present yourself with an offering before the Lord. I don't care. You may say, all I have in my bank account is $2. Bring an offering to the Lord. Bring an offering to the Lord. I don't care if it's 50 cents. Never appear before the Lord empty-handed. Do you hear me? It isn't right. Listen, it isn't right. I just don't want you to be doing something that isn't right. I don't want you to miss out on the blessing. It's not by constraint. You don't have to do it. But I'm going to tell you, if you want to step into the blessing and just fully in every way participate with what God's doing, just always bring the offering of your life. Bring something that represents your life. Amen. I want everybody in this place, find a bunch of people, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Ha ha. Jesus be praised. Jesus be Hallelujah. Oh, God. Oh, mighty God. Woohoo. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.